Hello, welcome. My name is Vivian Kamsimi, and we are talking the fight against corruption. The president has been on social media defending his fight against corruption and has mentioned a number of things that we are going to be talking about here and looking into the institutions that are supposed to be fighting corruption and why he could want other institutions to be coming in to fight this corruption. At the center of all this is the Iron Sheet scandal, where we have seen a number of government officials, key government officials, including the Vice President, the Speaker, the Prime Minister, Right Honorable Robina Nabanja. And we have also seen media reports with a letter from the President to the Prime Minister asking her to have all those who took Iron Sheets to return them, and he will be punishing those found culpable politically. I have to discuss with me tonight is senior multimedia journalist Charles Etukuri, who broke this story earlier this year, and Mr. Timothy Chemonges, a lawyer and a political analyst. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you so much.
Oh, yes. Mm. Charles, you have been at the center of this story, and you have told us a number of them in the papers. You have put out the lists of the different government officials that were involved in this Iron Sheet scandal. Yes. And we've seen it unfold from the time the State House Anti-Corruption Unit picked up or arrested the brother of the Honorable Minister Kitutu and her mother to this point. What do you make of all this?
Well, we, of course, Division, we broke this story around February 14th following a tip-off that there were some arrests that were being carried out in Namisi Indwa. Initially, it was the minister's mother. I think these people went and they saw someone buying iron sheets. So subsequently, they received the tip-off from a whistleblower. So when they went down on the ground, they actually bought some iron sheets from the minister's mother and the minister's brother separately. And they were able, actually during the conversations with these two people, they actually confessed that they still had more in stock. Mm. And so they came back, organized the recovery. So when the story first blew out, we initially never knew it was going to get to this. But I think a week after, as we're still trying to come on to terms with the first story, a subsequent list leaked out. And I think this was deliberately done because when we did the first, second, and third story, and then also eventually did the exposure of the minister who had roofed a house using iron sheets that were meant for the Prime Minister's office, someone deliberately leaked another list of people who are also beneficiaries, because we had two categories of ministers who got iron sheets. They are those who picked from the Karamoja Ministry, and there are those who picked from the office of the Prime Minister. So I think a group of people realized they were not going to go down alone. So they deliberately leaked another list. And this story has since grown to the point where we've reached. Now, initially when we broke this story...
Are you surprised by how it is unfolding?
Yes, we... Okay, I'm not surprised because first and foremost, a number of... This iron sheet, I think, is just a tip of the iceberg. A lot happens in government, and no one...
Corruption.
There's a lot of corruption in government, but it's... and I also want to thank the Vision Group, particularly where I work, because the constant... I think we became bold, and because of our boldness, we are seeing results actually coming out. Because this is the one story that we started, then we went after another one, then it actually grew. So we are also happy that alongside as we've been working on this story, we are getting, broadening our list of sources. And every time we get something new. Mm-hmm. And I'm also happy that whatever new thing we get, we've actually covered it conclusively. Of course, new tips keep on coming up every day. So the support from the public who are actually volunteering information, and also for our editors who are actually ensuring that we run these stories as they come in. So it is something that will eventually climax in us getting more stories about corruption. And I'm happy that the president now is talking about corruption. So this is what
he was engaged in a social media one-on-one with Abazukulu,
yes,
talking corruption.
Yes.
He has been talking about putting village units, anti-corruption,
yes,
units,
yes,
a number of other things. We are going to be discussing those.
Yes.
But let me get to Timothy here. The president is talking tough, at least from what we have seen from the letter to the Right Honorable Prime Minister Robina Nabanja, and also what we have seen on social media. And his Easter message, where he was talking about the corrupt getting caught, they are going to be, he's going to be tough on them, he's going to get them. Are we likely to see action against officials who were involved in this particular scandal, talking about the iron sheet scandal?
So thank you so much. And for the process, just to thank the Fourth Estate for the good work that they're doing in exposing the corruption menace. But also I know that it's bigger than as it is, really. The picture that is being fronted, mm-hmm. this is just, as Charles says, it is an iceberg. And probably to respond to that and to understand whether the this time round there is going to be action following what is happening, probably it's just fair to give it a bit of, to see where we are from in terms of actions which have been taken, mm-hmm. and the perception and the attitude of the current government in addressing corruption. And so you, first of all, you know, we must recognize that within our constitution and within our laws, there are institutions, but also there are mechanisms that the law provide in addressing this specific issue. However, in our current setting, the corruption aspect seems to be taking a political trajectory, as opposed to allowing institutions, the mechanisms which are provided within the law, to take action. And more often than not, we've seen the element of political interferences in terms of how corruption matters should be handled. And of course, when we finally get another time, maybe we shall talk how other elements within the sector have been handled. But specifically on corruption, I think understanding that it forms the biggest mess in terms of achieving the country's desires. So if you look at, for example, the Auditor General's reports.
And talking about that, you are a manager at the Parliamentary Watch, so you get to take a look at most of these reports that come to Parliament.
Yeah, so actually, if you, in 2019, the Office of the of IGG produced a report, and in that report, it showed that as a country, we lose close to 9.2 trillion. Of course, at the time, it's not the liquid cash, but also that constitutes the other resources that ideally should be invested, both in terms of manpower, but also resources that are injected in the day-to-day running of the government. And it's lost, so you lose close to 9.3 billion, 9.2 trillion of the total budget. Mm-hmm. And so that says that as a country, we still have a long way to address the aspect of corruption. But important to note is that corruption seems to be taking different forms, but also it's because action seems not to be taken on those who are involved in corruption. Every day you see the corrupt getting bolder. Yes. Those who ideally should be, those who are charged with certain responsibilities, you find them being very comfortable in the corruption space. And so I think that if you look at where we are from and where we are now, and probably try to give a very brilliant guess in terms of what should be, whether there is going to be action taken, I think that the probability is very limited. The probability is low. Although we
have an interesting take. Let me bring in Charles here. Charles, you just told us that you didn't see it unfolding this way.
Yes.
But now we are seeing the president's letters coming to the media. We have seen them being published. Even tomorrow, they're going to be in a New Vision. And I'm wondering, how did it get here?
No, I think the president is a bit disappointed, because when the president picked up this cabinet, I think he was quite sure. He talked about, I think, a cabinet of fishermen and fisherwomen or whatever. Now, it is reality is dawning on him that, you see, this Karamoja issue is a very delicate issue. One, at the peak of it all, we have General Salim Saleh in Karamoja right now, trying to mobilize the community, create food production, a number of things. Now, the community there has been a bit hostile, and it has taken a number of efforts for the government to try and normalize the situation. So it had the potential of exploding if government didn't handle it well. Now, well, the president is in a fix right now, because definitely this is almost, his cabinet has served almost 2 years. Now, with these people he thought were going to work with him for the 5 years of time, he's a bit disappointed. But what remains to be seen is whether he's going to take actual action, because it's not the first time that we have seen the president talk about taking action. I mean, there are so many things that behind your back, you know, there are so many reports that the president has on corruption issues. So we're only hoping that this time around, whatever he's writing, he actually puts it into action. And it can be put in action through a number of ways. Of course, there's a lot of lobbying. Like, for instance, today...
Just before we get there.
Yes.
Council, the president's role is clear in the constitution and who the kind of people who should take center stage in these kinds of activities. When it comes to investigations, police does the investigations, then they take these people to court, charge them, and then the process continues. But we have seen people boldly coming out on social media, and he calls them bazukulu. Somehow he knows that it's the bazukulu who are on social media. They've taken on the president. They have questioned his role in this corruption issue. And I'm wondering, why do you think people still want to hold him accountable, even when they know that his role should be political? In fact, he tweeted that the president and other political leaders exercise power given to them by the constitution through making policy, legislation, and sometimes creating new departments or agencies to achieve tasks. So he says that is their role as political heads in institutions. So why do people think that they still want to hold him accountable?
So first, of course, is to appreciate that the president within our system holds a lot of power.
Strong.
And corruption, actually, more it can be dealt if there is a political will. The political will, and especially in third world countries, enable the systems to take action as far as corruption is concerned. And because of the power they wield, if the head of state toes line and says we are not going to have corruption, it will substantially reduce. But also more importantly, I think that you mentioned on the on how the Vazukulu, but also the general public, are coming out in demanding for accountability. An item that I think that if we strengthen that element, I think it's where there is a bit of a missing link. The public need to be more proactive in demanding for accountability, other than just leaving this matter to the politician and some of these other entities that probably they are likely to be compromised sometimes. There should be power given back to the citizens to hold the leaders accountable. And I'm seeing what's
that
happening.
That sort of comes to political capital.
Yeah,
because the government needs that political capital. They need survival. They need to be.
Today I saw as a
politically stable.
The tone of disappointment in most of the youths, because the reason why they wanted to hold the president accountable was simply because he keeps on regurgitating some of these elements that have been mentioned in a number of corruption scandals. And also, even though the president has put in place a number of agencies to fight corruption, a number of these people, by the way, are being protected by some of these people. I will give you there are a number of cases.
You said a number of people are being protected by some of these people.
Yes,
who
there are people,
these people
who have become so bold, who are so corrupt and bold that you can't take them anywhere. That's also a fact. There are people who have been censured, people who have been fired, but the president keeps on recycling them back. So the reason why you saw that Twitter mod was people. What, because the president should mean what he says. If I have been held or been charged with corruption or been censured, why should I be brought back into cabinet? So that's why you see some of those voices. People, because people are mentioning names. Some of these people who are mentioned in this Mabati issue are people who are so close to the president. Some of them are so senior people in government. So people want action. People want to see heads rolling. And in fact, I spoke to one of the investigators who told me one of the biggest challenges they faced was that going to pick a statement from somebody who has like 10 guards at his home. You know, you even feel threatened moving there. So that kind of environment was not making them operate freely. But you see, it's these people are appointed by the president, they are his cabinet members. So That's why the youths feel like exploding. And if he doesn't handle it well, it has the potential. And that's why I wouldn't advise that we should take over these issues of accountability to the public, because it has a potential of creating a very explosive situation. So the president should actually act. He should mean what he wrote. He should mean what he says. It should be a matter of, because I mean, he has already received briefs from these intelligence heads. They have told him that he knows that so and so. Already by there in the public eye, people know. I mean, if I've used my iron sheets for roofing, my private cow shed, what other evidence do you need to take action? So the more he takes, the more he continues engaging us on Twitter, people get disappointed. That's why you saw some of the tone on social media wasn't very friendly.
Okay, in Uganda, you're talking about entities that should be dealing with corruption.
Yes.
That discussion came up when the president says or wrote that on the side of corruption as president, I have put in place the following leadership code.
Mm.
The office of the IGG, the State House Health Monitoring Committee, the State House Anti-Corruption Unit, etc., 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 etc. All this was in addition to the previously existing accountability bodies such as the Auditor General, the CID, ESO, Parliamentary Oversight Committees, and so on. Why haven't these been sufficient in dealing with corruption?
True. And
Timothy.
And I think that's where the real question is. We already have the constitutionally provided mechanisms. In terms of the legislative framework, that's quite sufficient.
That's true.
In terms of the, you look at the Auditor General, the Auditor General is there, the IGG. Within Parliament, there are accountability committees that help to probe these matters.
Yes.
And even when these matters are brought forth, they don't receive the attention that they should.
Mm.
And so the missing link is in the action, is in making corruption a very, very risky venture.
Yes.
As we stand today, it's an area that many people can comfortably be.
Mm.
You've seen ministers who have been previously implicated in corruption,
yes,
comfortably coming back in the docket. And so it projects corruption as something that is not very, very serious.
Mm.
Yet it substantially affects the running of the country. Just to mention, in our current the current budget which is being processed is projected to be around 50.92 trillion. Of that, close to 26 trillion is what even we're not going to handle. It goes into loan repayments and what have you. The remaining close to 24% to 24 trillion, you have, that's where you find largely the discretionary budget that includes the salaries, which essentially actually they should, it does not qualify to be discretionary budget, because if you have salaries, if you have gratuity, your pension, and these other, you literally have less than 7 trillion going to service delivery. If you include corruption already on that, it means then that service delivery is affected substantially. And if you look at what the Auditor General report actually highlights, including the recently, the championed the parish development model, which is a good initiative.
And the president has already highlighted corruption there.
Mm. No, actually, the president, it is the role of the Auditor General to check, because that's his mandate.
Mm.
And if you look at the recent report, which actually was presented before the House, that's Parliament, it actually highlights a lot of anomalies, a lot of discrepancies in terms of management, in terms of disbursement, in terms of the chiefs who were recruited to oversee the whole process, in terms of the registration of circles and all that kind of thing.
And the president actually said that when he went on the northern, that part of Uganda, the northern part of Uganda, on a visit, people came up with stories of corruption tendencies in PDM and how the money was being taken away.
See, the other thing also is that they're putting in place of many of these agencies and the different laws we have in place are not helping in the fight against corruption. Simply
why?
Because I will give you an example. If you talk about those parliamentary committees we have in the House, some of them are actually sanitizing places where corruption takes place. And I'll give you an example. We have had the office of the IGG for a number of years. Until recently, when they put in place SHACO, IGG does a number of works, positive investigations. But until recently, we should also appreciate that the coming on board of SHACO has somehow changed. Of course, sometimes they have also gone a bit astray. But I would actually highly commend. We needed more. My feeling is that we should make corruption something that people should not want to venture into. Why would you arrest? I'll give you an example. I've read a lot of stories from the neighboring countries. Recently in Kenya, there was an issue of maize scandal. Somebody was arrested over, I think they conned the government some. He was made to pay 10 times what he had stolen. So if we had in place tougher laws, if these agencies that are fighting corruption worked together, because why would we have SHACO investigating the issue of iron sheets? Okay, SHACO worked with CID. We had the IGG,
State House
and Corruption Unit. We had IGG also doing the same investigation. We had Parliament also following up the same investigation. So let's try to streamline, because you see, we are now trying to. We should focus. We should have focused investigations, not just, because some of these investigations are just meant to sanitize. So the more the agencies we have, because I've seen the president talking about setting up another agency, we need to strengthen the agencies that we have right now. Then ensure that we work closely with the judiciary to make corruption a crime that no one would wish to go into. That's the only way people outside there will feel we are doing something. But however much the president lists the laws, how many people have gone in? He just talked, we are missing almost 9.2 trillion shillings, which is going to be stolen in this budget or in the previous budgets. But as long as we don't have people, and these people are known, by the way. We had one time we talked about lifestyle audits. Apart from the IGG addressing the press, the media, what has she done? Mm. So let's try to be a bit more serious on what we do. So my urge would be the president should be listing laws, but we need to have the relevant agencies actually act. That's when we shall have people getting back this confidence that finally the government is fighting corruption. So however much we talk, however much we list the laws, if no action is being done, then it's a waste of time. That's my thought.
Yeah. Council Timothy here. The president wants anti-corruption units at village level. How does the law provide for these?
So first, of course, is to appreciate that the we have a legal framework that helps to govern this sector, and that is largely based the Anti-Corruption Act. But also, you say that that is a product of the Penal Code Act.
Yes.
The legislators, in their wisdom, after looking and understanding the aspect of corruption, they enacted the law independent to address this specific. But it largely addresses corruption, and largely, without saying that this is at the local, because corruption is corruption, notwithstanding where it's happening. It is on the identification and the prosecution. Also, we must say that prosecuting sometimes corruption can be very tricky, especially when it comes to getting the evidence. And today, of course, we must say that corruption is taking very, very modernized ways of, it's manifesting in different forms. And it becomes very, very tricky. And so that also means that the state has to be smarter, but also be up to date, because then you don't want to. So, for example, the case of Minister Chitutu, she has already been arraigned before the courts. So the fair thing is that that case is prosecuted to the end. But also that must be facilitated with sufficient evidence.
You see, that is, according to him, the work of the State House Anti-Corruption Unit. And he says he should have other units that are doing that to deal with village matters besides levels like those.
No, but it's, you see, it's also not true that we don't have, it's not true that we don't have structures that can identify. If you look at, for example, the aspect of corruption, I know that we run a devolved government where we have the local government systems. And I could follow recently when the Minister Ogwang, before he went to Ministry of Sports, he was doing some monitoring evaluation around the country. And you could see that clearly there is a missing gap, and the resources that go down to the local government, much of it is not utilized as it should be. That is not to exonerate the failures in the national government. A lot of mess is equally there. So the thing is in being able to prosecute those cases, being able to provide the political will and people not to hide behind the big man syndrome, that I have someone behind me, I can be able. And so that was.
So in short, we do not need those village anti-corruption.
I don't think if we need them for now.
Just tell me. Just before I get into that.
We should make a. We should create a put in place hotlines.
Mm.
I think we don't even need this. The president should make reporting corruption as an easy way. We don't need, because you see, setting this up already is going to involve issues of money. Someone is going to submit a supplementary budget, you know, with our Uganda here. What we should do is that let's ensure that we put in place systems, put in place a toll-free line. I'm sure some of these agencies have them, but let's follow up on these cases that are reported. If I'm in Karamoja, I should have I don't have to have a committee on the ground, because when I report, someone else is going to expose me out. Let's have phone calls. Someone can call from Karamoja, Teso, Acholi, Lango, Busia, Western Uganda. We report these cases. And the burden also is on the community. Let's not glorify thieves. But the other challenge that we also face is that we tend to glorify thieves and we tend to protect them once they are one of our own. So we should actually come out a lot of sensitization needs to be done. Let's sensitize the public, let them come out and report. Because it's either my brother, sister, who is building a beautiful home because of corruption, who is buying a good car, who is... You know, so let's have these things put in place before we think about setting up this village corruption.
Let's hold it there. We are going for a short break and we will be back. We are talking the fight against corruption with two gentlemen here, senior journalist Charles Etukuri and lawyer policy analyst Mr. Timothy Chemonges. Let's be back.